Good evening and welcome to this forum for Stevens Point Common Council candidates. And as Jan said, my name is Sue Buck and I am a member of the League of Women Voters of the Stevens Point area, and I'm honored to serve as your moderator for this forum. The Stevens Point Common Council includes alderpersons representing 11 districts. Alderpersons from the odd-numbered wards are elected the first Tuesday in April in the odd-numbered years. So this year, on April 4th, Stevens Point residents will elect alderpersons from city districts of 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, and 11. All official candidates with opposition have been invited to attend this forum. Therefore, we have invited candidates from districts 1, 3, and 9 to take part in our forum tonight. They are elected for two-year terms, and those alderpersons elected in April will earn an annual salary of $5,300. Candidates themselves must be present. However, a candidate who is not able to attend may provide written information at the candidate's table along with the other candidate's information. Tonight, six candidates are present, and we're pleased that they were able to join us this evening. Running for the Alderperson District 1 seat is George Dockstader and Tori Jennings. Cindy Nabel and Christopher Villarreal are vying for District 3 Alderperson seat. And running for the Alderperson District 9 seat are Polly Dalton and Mary McComb. In order to provide the most time to hear from the candidates and to provide a fair and equal opportunity to answer questions important to you and this community, I will review the format, time, and terms for this forum. And this has also been reviewed with the candidates. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to introduce themselves and make an opening statement. Then they will have a minute and a half to respond to the questions. And I will repeat the questions if you need me to when requested. Candidates will respond first to some questions submitted by the league and then questions from the audience. Questions from the audience must be addressed to all the candidates. If you want to submit a question, please motion to one of the ushers. I think Michelle and Denise over here have the index cards and pencils. The league reserves the right to review and screen questions for relevance and to avoid duplication. Our timers are located right in front here of the candidate table. A green folder will be held up when the time starts. A yellow folder indicates 30 seconds remain, and the red folder means the time has expired. Candidates may finish their sentence and then please stop so the next candidate may begin their response. Candidates are asked to keep their remarks germane to the questions and fair to the participants. And the moderator reserves the right to interrupt to ensure that these ground rules are observed. The order of response to each question will be rotated. We will alternate which candidate answers the question first. The order of the opening statements will be chosen by random drawing of the candidates' names. We now begin with a 2-minute opening statement from each candidate. And here's my scientifically
the red cup.
drawing cup. And so our first opening statement will be Christopher Villarreal.
Go figure. All right. Well, good evening. My name is Chris Villarreal. I'm running for 3rd District Alderperson. I'm running for Alderperson to give people who can't or are too scared or just don't know how to speak up a voice within the city of Stevens Point. All my life I've been told I should be a politician. Not just because I have a big mouth, but because I'm a good listener and even a better problem solver. I believe in integrity first, duty before self, and excellence in all I do. I've been a Park Ridge firefighter for over 10 years now. I've served Mid-State Technical College and all 16 technical colleges in the state of Wisconsin as a vice president of student government. I am a strong advocate for student issues and building a better tomorrow for Stevens Point. I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters for this great opportunity to share my ideas for making Stevens Point a better place for tomorrow. Thank you.
All right, thank you. And our next opening statement will be Tori Jennings.
Hi, my name is Tori Jennings. Thank you to the League of Women Voters for hosting this forum. I have lived in District 1 for 7 years. I am running for District 1 Alder because I believe our diverse neighborhoods need responsive representation and strong leadership. I've demonstrated my commitment to our community and District 1, and my record speaks for itself. For example, I am co-founder of the grassroots organization Revisioning Point. Since 2014, Revisioning Point has been generating ideas and hosting workshops and facilitating a citizen-led conversation about redevelopment and transportation in Stevens Point. I am chair of the Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Committee. I co-authored the city's successful TAP grant that will fund 80% of a nearly $500,000 transportation improvement project that will link businesses and areas of shopping throughout the city. On my own, I have worked with business owners and the Director of Public Works and Common Council to add bike parking downtown for the convenience of shoppers. I also work with the director to rearrange street furniture and rubbish bins to improve people's experiences downtown. These small incremental changes have made a big difference. I bring a professional background that suits me to this job. I spent 13 years in the fire service. I rose through the ranks as a firefighter, paramedic, engineer, and captain for the City of Littleton Fire Department in Colorado. I was the first person in my family to attend college, and now I have a PhD in anthropology from UW-Madison. I also am a graduate of the Farm and Industry Short Course at UW-Madison and spent a year milking cows on a traditional dairy farm in southwest Wisconsin. I've been studying rural communities and small cities for almost 3 decades. I'm running for Alder to help make Stevens Point the most livable small city in Wisconsin.
Thank you. Our next opening statement will be Polly Dalton.
Good evening. Thank you to the League of Women Voters for providing this platform for all the candidates to represent their voice. The easy answer for this question, why would I be running, I think all of us here can simply say, well, we love this community and we want to serve it in some way. But we all have a very diverse background in why we love this community. And mine is pretty unique and pretty short, I guess. I only moved here 2 years ago. And while that raises some eyebrows for a lot of folks, I moved here intentionally. I didn't go to school here. I didn't grow up here. But I did meet a lot of people in this community who are working on something. And when I was about to start my own small business, a farm out here, my partner and I knew we wanted to move to this community because of the residents here and the character that we had learned from them, and we wanted to be a part of something. So I bring a diverse set of experience from that. When I moved here from Appleton, I was serving on the city council there. It is a large community where I had to vote up and down on multi-million dollar projects, deal with voting licenses for bartenders, for people who had police records on issues in their backgrounds. But I think those experiences, along with being a small business owner where I have to constantly solve problems creatively, think about strategic investments, and think forward a few years, can bring a good perspective to the role of city alderperson. Thank you.
Thank you. I feel like I'm opening Chinese fortune cookies. Cindy Nabel.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Cindy Nabel, and I would like to thank everybody for coming to this forum and for the fact that there is a forum for us to be able to talk a little bit more about ourselves and the reasons why we're running. I'm running for city council because I want to represent the constituents in my area, District 3, but also for all of Stevens Point. Although I didn't live here all my life, I've lived here more than half of my life. And I've lived on Phillips Street for over 37 years, and my husband and I teach in the district, and we both have bought in our house. We've committed to this district, to this town, and we really love it. We raise our children here. We live in a diverse neighborhood. And the fact I say diverse isn't just about culture, but age age differences, too. We have a lot of elderly people that live in our neighborhood. We had more families at one time, and we have students in there. When we bought our house, we knew we had student rentals across from us. It wasn't any surprise, so we did it knowingly. We are still there, and we still love living in Stevens Point and living near the campus in downtown. I wanted this opportunity to say that, for me, I could speak for behalf of my neighborhoods and my neighbors, and advocate for the city growth that we really need, and the strategic ways that we will build our city's tax base. Some of the biggest challenges I think that we're going to face are our growth. And I'm hoping that we will look at our neighborhoods as being an important part of that growth, and that we need that as our foundation to strengthen our city and to make sure that people want to live here and reside here and not just move into further directions. I bring to this that I've been in the Old Main Neighborhood Association for over 10 years, and I'm now president. I'm with the Emerson Group for the park, and trying to work on that project, and I've worked with the university and many people to try to get cooperation and working together for betterment for students and for homeowners within our area. Thank you.
Thank you. Mary McComb.
Hi, I'm Mary McComb. I was born and raised in Stevens Point and returned here 12 years ago after many years away. I know Stevens Point. I've been a waitress at South Point and Country Kitchen and even the Hollywood Wayside. I've been a worker at Warzala Printing, the paper mill, and Travel Guard. I've been a student and a professor at UWSP. And for 10 years, I've been a downtown business owner. I know things about Stevens Point. I know that we work hard, that we're friendly, that we're welcoming, that we're proud of our city, and that we love our natural resources. I also know that we can be cautious about change. I've lived in District 9 12 years, the last two, as the alderperson. I've been involved in community issues for 10 years, and so I know how to get things done, whether that's a community dog park, a redesigned public square, a revitalizing downtown. As the alder, I've helped keep Edgewater affordable public, city-owned housing for people 55 plus. I've helped prevent overdevelopment off West River Drive. I've helped rewrite city policies for worker protections, among others. I know how to collaborate with residents, city staff, and officials. I will listen to you. I will be honest. I will speak out for a sustainable quality of life. I've been committed to my hometown for years. Being elected in 2015 resulted from District 9 residents knowing my achievements and dedication to Stevens Point. I'm not driven by ambition. I'm motivated by caring for Stevens Point. We know each other, we care for each other, and we're committed to Stevens Point.
Thank you. And our last opening statement, George Docksitter.
Oh yeah, you can't muck that up like the Oscars.
Nope, I can't.
good evening. My name is George Docksitter. I'd like to thank everybody for coming tonight. My other esteemed candidates, fellow city employees, people that work there, and everybody in the audience. I was born and raised in Stevens Point. Grew up on Ellis Street until 1980, and then my parents moved me to the first district. And what a great district it is, because living on Plover Street, I got to see a whole different world of Catholics and public schools and everybody who worked there. The question is, tell us why you want to be a city alderperson and what qualifies you to become an alderperson. Well, I am an alderperson. 4 years ago, my parents said, why don't you become an alderperson? Nobody's running. I said, why don't you? You're retired. They said, well, we didn't help pay for your political science degree from UWSP to not get anything out of it. So I ran for alderperson, and I'm so glad I did, because I really believe in service to one's community. I became a firefighter at Whiting because I believe in service and helping people. I became an EMT because I wanted to help people. And all this has accumulated into a service-oriented background, which I think I got through, you know, a good upbringing from my parents and living in Stevens Point with such great people. I've worked as alderman for 4 years. I've been on the Board of Public Works for 3. I was on Public Protection for 3 years. I've chaired that for 1 year. I was on the Finance. I am on the Finance Committee, and I'm the Vice Chairman. And 4 years ago, and 3 administrations ago, I fought the mayor really hard for ADA rights for a resident over at the high-rise. And he was nice enough to award me a spot on the Housing Authority for 5 years, which I am a vice chair at. And continuing, I like service comes with continuity. We keep working towards goals. All of the things that we've done for 4 years have projects, and they keep going. And the accumulation of these projects turn out to be a grade separation. And that is all the time I have, but I appreciate you coming. Thanks.
Thank you. We will move on to the first league question, and we'll begin with the candidates for District 1 and continue with District 3 and 9. And then we will rotate each district and candidate. And each candidate will have a minute and a half to answer the questions. And we will conclude by 7:30. And I do need to ask that the candidates, there's a microphone that's closer to you than farther. The one that's farther, no, that one leave alone. That one is for the videographer.
Good.
But there's 3 other ones that are closer to you that you're going to have to share between you two. And you need to move it back and forth so that the people in the audience can hear you, if you would, please.
Do we need to push the button, or is it?
No, the button's good. It's okay. All on. Okay, thank you so much. So, since Mr. Dockstader.
Since I went last, I get to
you
go
get
first?
You get to go first. Oh, how's
thanks.
That?
Thank you.
Anytime. Okay. And here's the first question. What are the important issues facing the city that the city council needs to consider?
The important issues would be, for our television and radio audiences, as the mayor likes to remind us, we have to use the microphone. The most important issue I'm seeing in the next 3 to 4 years is getting City Hall moved and the police department a safer place. I like to see us get out of the basement of the county city building and find our own home, since we're pouring $325,000 a year into the 27.5% of, or 41% of it, whatever it is, Corey, that we own of it a year. And that money could be much better spent housing our city hall with offices that are integrated and everybody can see each other, go through. We had a great plan for the old Mid-State, and people could walk in the door and go wherever they needed to be, and we weren't jumping all over playing Frogger in the county city building. The police department has been skidding underneath that under ramp for years, and it keeps getting kicked down the road, as people like to say. And I believe it's very important, especially with what we saw happen up in Wausau last week, that our police department has to be, in a good place where they can get in their cars, like the sheriffs have here, and they're in, they're out, they're moving out and finding, helping out our community where they need to be. We good?
All right. Thank you. And Tori Jennings.
The most important issue is the budget is always a chief concern, and being fiscally responsible. I think having a coherent policy for development is really important, and having a sustainable direction with that development. I agree that finding a home, permanent home for a police department is extremely important. And another issue that the community will be facing, discussing further this year, is going to be parking.
All right, moving along to Cindy Nabel.
Thank you. Hi. There's quite a few that are going to be coming up, and one of them that I've been looking at is and has been addressed recently is the important issue that our city is going to face about strategically planning development and our economic growth. Once the findings are completed from the city's current housing study, the challenge is going to be on how to best position the city itself to meet the needs that we find in that study and what wants there are for our residents. In addition, we will also face issues on how we can best utilize our roadways for all modes of transportation and in order to extend their lifeability as a source of transportation, as they are very expensive to upkeep. Another thing that I think will be a big thing is that the state levy that we have is capped. So restricting local control we have had through the state, the city needs to find ways to grow and increase our commercial development and our residential. And it should be something that's well planned and designed to meet long-term sustainability goals. My other thing is that I really believe also that Mr. Doxeter mentioned about the police department. It's very important that we support them and let them know that it is important where they are, where they're residing, and where they're going to be. Thank you.
Thank you. Christopher Villarreal.
Thank you. I also believe parking is going to be a major issue within the city, and it has to be parking that's fair for everyone. We also need to start planning for tomorrow. We have seen in the past companies disappear, either gone to Mexico or just shut down. We've seen the paper mill do this, and we really don't know the future of our industry in Stevens Point. We need to bring in a diverse industries, diverse companies, and stop relying on just the companies we have. This will also help bring up wages and more jobs for people. These are things that we need to think about to help improve our economy for the future.
Thank you. And Polly Dalton.
I've not been shy about saying this when talking with residents, but housing affordability and opportunity is by far the most important issue facing our city in the next few years. As a young person moving here, not as a student, I had a hard time finding a place to rent initially, something that was affordable and fit the style, my lifestyle. And now I am a homeowner and a landlord to a tenant, and I am becoming even more aware of all the issues facing property owners. So when we look at housing opportunities, a lot of it comes down to how we address development and planning in our zoning code. And so one of the main reasons I'm running this year is that the city is about to redo its zoning code, which was written in 1979, before my parents even graduated from college. And so there's definitely modernizing that needs to be done, clarifying that needs to be done. And in doing that and being a part of that process, being a voice in that process, I believe I can continue to move the city forward and how it looks at housing developments.
Thank you. And Mary McComb.
Number one, and these are not in order, would be we're going to be, hopefully, people are going to want to develop in Stevens Point, whether it's housing or industry or businesses. And so we can't develop solely for the tax base. We have to think of quality of life for people with any development. I'd like to see us avoid excess sprawl and encourage infill development. We need to make sure that business development offers good careers for people, not just minimum wage jobs. So there's a lot of things to think about with development. Second would be city space needs. I've toured the police department. I've been down there several times, not as an arrestee, but there are some real difficulties with our current police department. One of them is that witnesses and crime victims can cross paths easily. Third is neighborhoods. I'm looking forward to working on the new zoning. We need to have zoning that allows people to have creative yards, not just the mowed lawn. Our new neighborhood improvement coordinator is very interested in helping people keep their properties up, as well as he's not so concerned about just issuing ordinances.
Okay, thank you. We'll move on to question number two, and we will start with the District 3 candidates, and we'll start with Christopher Villarreal. And the question is, can you comment on a decision made by the City Council that you agreed or disagreed with recently, and why?
Yeah, I think I can. It's basically the last Common Council meeting. There was a big discussion about a cell phone tower. Obviously, there's some confusion with how the state legislator, the state deems what the cell phone tower is and how it can automatically just be there. Again, we need to bring revenue into the city. We need to bring revenue in as much as possible. These cell phone towers do help bring in revenue. It just doesn't help the landowner. It also helps the city. So if we have chances to bring in revenue and it doesn't really impede how the city looks or aesthetics of the city, I don't see any reason why there should be an argument. It's bringing in money, and that's definitely going to help us in the long run.
Okay, and Cindy Nabel.
Well, there's a couple things that I notice and been very happy to see that have been happening in our city with the Common Council. One was definitely that we were able to get a full-time neighborhood improvement coordinator. Mark has been great, and it's been really nice to have somebody that's looking at new ideas of how to get that out to people when there are issues, to try to make not just get fines to people, but to try to teach and educate people of why this is why you can't have things certain ways for the ordinances. We need to work on our neighborhoods. I think they're really important, and we have let them go quite a long time without having that kind of strength of looking at them. They've also made that bridge is really important because they are making that so that it assists the owners and property owners and the residents and the community as a whole. One of the things I have a little bit been confused about is about the parking that we're looking at doing, and the budget itself, it got budgeted prior to all of the things being ironed out. And I know that you had to have a budget set up for this year, but it seems that there's a lot of questions there about people that are paying for taxes already, and now they're going to be paying for if they get a permit. Questions about students, about having a parking spot and making it more not fair to them. So I think that those conversations should have been happening a little bit more prior to us budgeting for it. Thank you.
Thank you. And we'll move to our candidates for District 9, and we'll start with Mary McComb.
Could you please repeat the question?
Sure, I'd be glad to. Can you comment on a decision made by the City Council that you agreed or disagreed with recently, and why?
Okay. We'll go back to the cell tower. The cell tower is going to be built in my district. It's going to be built near a small residential district, an old residential district. It's not particularly a wealthy residential district. Under state statute, municipalities' grounds for denying cell tower permits have been vastly reduced. We can only deny a cell tower permit because of safety or health. No longer can communities deny a cell tower permit because of aesthetics. And that is what the homeowners in the area are concerned about, aesthetics and loss of property value. So the city really had our hands tied. We could have just said no, but it wouldn't have made any difference. I voted against it, even though I knew it wouldn't make any difference, because my constituents were concerned, and I would have liked to seen City Council make a statement by saying, we're voting no. We know we can't do anything about it, but we think that this is a bad decision for the city. The person who's going to make revenue from it is primarily the landowner who is renting the property for the cell tower. It won't benefit the neighborhood.
Okay, thank you. Polly Dalton.
This past summer, the council took a vote on a conditional use permit for the building of and construction of Cobblestone Hotel in downtown. While I am skeptical of that project developing, though I recognize the benefits of a hotel being downtown, my commentary on the decision was the failure of the council to recognize their power to include certain conditions in that conditional use permit. There was discussion on the floor regarding the usage of historic facade materials and that they disapproved of certain components of it, such as utilizing local builders in the construction of it. What the council failed to realize is that they had the power to at least vote on those options as a part of the permit. And in doing so, they failed to follow through on that power. So that was a disappointing. I do have to say, in the last meeting, the last week or two, there has been discussions of a development, housing development on the east side. And I do agree with the vote that Mary put, though there was some discussion that the city really had no legal grounds to deny the housing development on the east side. I'm glad that Mary and a few other council members took the stand to deny that, as I would have as well, though their vote failed.
Thank you. And now for our District 1 candidates, and we'll go with Tori Jennings first.
A number of the decisions that this council has been faced with this year were set into motion by previous councils, and therefore the decisions that they made were an extension of what had already been set in motion. And one example is a new bar is opening downtown. Now, District 1 is especially impacted by the bars downtown. Bars that are open until 2:30 in the morning that cater primarily to college students, and their entire economic model is based on this kind of service. And so the traffic of intoxicated, mostly college students, not all, going back and forth to the bars downtown is a problem for District 1. And so something that I'm interested in is figuring out and working with businesses to figure out how do we broaden the economic model so that they can be prosperous in different ways. So these bars have been operating this way for a long time, but it may not be a way that they're going to stay prosperous. And most of them will say they're not making any money. So how can they become more prosperous for the changing community that we now have? Different hours being open. Can there be more outside seating where you can have a beer outside? Nice spaces. Let's use the square differently. Can we have a beer garden type space where people can be served out in that area without having to set up orange fencing, et cetera?
Okay. Thank you. And George Dockstader.
And this was a comment on a decision by council that you agree or disagree with?
And why?
And why? Well, I'm glad that they brought that up about the Parkdale project. The overturning of the Planning Commission by the council on the 20th was just what had to happen there. It might have gone 6-5, 7-4, but the only way to save that wetland for future generations was to allow those people to build the Point of Beginning project and the Blinker townhouses. The Planning Commission had okayed 3 out of 4 steps for this project to happen. And then at the end of it, they decided, well, we can't okay the site plan, and put the kibosh on it. If the council hadn't opened that up, the city would be losing $100,000 in tax revenue over the next 10, 20 years. More businesses. I heard so many business people over there say, you've got to let this project happen because all these people come to my business. They eat there. They have people that stay in these hotels here. And the city it's got one way to go, and that's east. We can't go north. We can't go west. We can't go south because of Plover. We're still going to grow, but growth in a good way. Those wetlands could have been filled in like all the other wetlands that used to be known as the Jordan Swamp out there. All that was wetland. When I grew up, you know, University Lake was a bunch of pine trees. It happens. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you. We're going to move on to the next question. We'll start with our candidates from District 9 and with Polly Dalton first. And the question is, it's from the audience, what are your specific thoughts on lane reductions? Do you support lane reductions, specifically Stanley Street and Division Street?
I've not been shy in talking to constituents that I am very in favor of a 4-to-3 lane conversion on Division Street, not only because of bicycle safety, which is kind of how the project is being painted. I am a cyclist, and that's great, and I think a lot of young people and people that are interested in alternative form of transportation are excited to hear about that. But I also believe it's bringing a significant amount of vehicle safety to the left turns that occur across Division Street, which right now can be chaotic and cause a lot of the congestion that develops on that road. A 4-to-3 lane conversion on Division Street, or the 4-to-3 conversion method, has been successful in a lot of other communities, and I believe it will be successful here as well. And I believe it will serve an important backbone between the north and south ends of the community for university students and Southside residents to more easily travel north and south throughout the community.
Okay, thank you. Mary McComb.
Polly, high five. I have looked into 4-to-3 lane conversions a lot, and I agree that these would be excellent for Stanley Street and Division Street. Research has shown, and experience has shown in many cities around the country of all different sizes, that 4-to-3 lane conversions reduce collision points for autos. It makes the street safer for bicyclists and safer for pedestrians who are walking along the street, and also more pleasant for the neighbors who live along the street. I think the Scott Schatzschneider told me several months ago there have been 90 accidents on Stanley Street over the last several years. They haven't been serious, but that's a lot of accidents for that corridor. I walk my dog nearly every night, and I would love to walk across Division Street. And of course, I can cross Division Street, but it is scary and difficult. It takes a perfectly nice dog walk and makes it tense. So I just spend my time on my side of Division Street. I think especially on a Division Street, 4-to-3 in the center part of Division Street from, say, Carl D's up to 4th would be a wonderful improvement for our city.
Thank you. And our excuse me, our District 1 candidates, and we'll go with George Dockstader.
Stanley Street, I would suggest we reduce speeds on Stanley Street. Knock it down to 25, the people can slow down over there. It's not on the comp plan with the county to repaint it and make it into a 4-to-3 lane conversion. That $50,000 in paint that we spend on that would be better spent on North Point from Spash over to Wilshire, where we have a lot more green circle traffic. If we need flashing hawk lights at every intersection to get bikes and peds across Stanley Street, or at Divisions down by Belts or Carl D's, I'm all for that. We went through this big fight with the city did with AECOM leading the way for a 4-to-3 lane conversion. And since the city, with the sins of our fathers 10 years ago, took the money from the DOT, all that money that you see rebuilding Plover and Whiting right now, we put it into a different pot, and now we're going to have to pay for it. We'll have to do the south part from the track south and get that fixed first. And I do like the idea of possibly a two-lane with a twiddle in the middle going up from the railroad tracks north up to 4th Avenue. Thank you.
Can I ask Mr. Doctor, be sure you're talking more directly into the mic. You're a little bit hard to hear out here.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Thank you. And Tori Jennings.
North Point is already budgeted for, and striping will proceed, as I understand it, on North Point after the school year. 4-to-3 lane reductions are a traffic calming technique, a well-proven technique. It improves safety for all road users. and makes communities more livable. It raises property values. It improves access and safety to and from businesses. This is also a great way to beautify a street. Our four undivided four-lane roadways, which are an antiquated model of engineering, are the entryways, the entry corridors to our city, and they are the most unattractive, unsafe routes we have. As entryway corridors, they should be beautiful. By going to a 4-to-3-lane conversion, the space that's opened up from that conversion allows for beautification techniques. So that can be built into pedestrian islands and also any other engineering that goes into that that can become part of it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Cindy Nabel.
Hi. The three to four lane conversion is something that I have had to look into more because I didn't know a lot about it prior to the last 2 months, but I have now been more aware of it. And I also saw that as I traveled through, like where my daughter is in Sun Prairie, that they have it. And then I saw areas that they didn't have it. And it was very interesting to see exactly what's been talked about and how my daughter complains as she goes from Madison area over to get to work at Sun Prairie, how bad the traffic is and how many accidents are almost always happening because they don't have a designated lane for turning. It would make a big difference, and Division Street's always been a very unpleasant looking area. It has been since I've lived here, which is over 40 years. So I find it that this would be really a good way for us to really make it a place that people would like to see come in, and it's more welcoming to Stevens Point instead of it looking so run down. It's an entryway, we need to keep it that way. And Stanley Street, if I was living there, I probably would have a problem like some people are about, you know, getting out of their driveways. But I got to say, even lowering the speed on that, people speed on that because there's not as much traffic and you're coming off of a highway and it's four lane and it just looks like it should go faster. Think about Patch Street. They did change Patch Street. Patch Street wasn't happy about it, but it sure slowed me down.
Okay, thank you. And Christopher Villarreal.
Thank you. As far as aesthetics, you can just look at what Plover has done with in front of their fire department up through the ballpark. How much nicer that is, how much easier it is to move around, and it's just darn right beautiful. My other point is, with this, is you ever try to drive a fire truck through Stevens Point? I have. And granted, Park Ridge has a little bit smaller fire truck than Stevens Point's ladder, but they're both heavy trucks. And I can tell you, driving the ladder, driving an ambulance down Division Street is hectic and very difficult to do. And you have to pay very close attention. So if we can add more space, add a turning lane, it is just going to make public safety so much easier. And when you're running a code 3, lights and sirens, it makes your driving and the driver operators just a lot smoother and safer. And really, that's what it's going to have to come down to, is the safety of our drivers and safety of our public service.
Okay. Thank you. And we'll move on to the next question, which is also from our audience. And we will start with District 1 candidates again. We'll start with Tori Jennings. Describe your awareness of our community's changing demographics, the aging of our county, and then tell us how you intend to attract and retain young professionals to Stevens Point.
Okay, changing demographics. I'll address it through this way. Improving livability is the key to attracting business. And attracting business and commercial sites is what increases the tax base. That's where the money is. It's not in residential. So when you create a livable community, that means good schools, safe, attractive neighborhoods, and bikeable, walkable communities, that attracts people to the place. And a lot of these people are young families. That's what attracts business. That's the economic model now. So people go to a place and the businesses go to those places where their workers are. unlike the days when the business would set up and the workers went to where the business is. So it all revolves around improving livability. And the thing is, both young people, young professionals, and the elderly benefit from improved livability, being able to get around, walk, be safe, be confident in your strong in the strength of your community. That benefits everybody. So both ends of the spectrum, as well as everybody in the middle.
Thank you. And George Dockstader.
Can you repeat the question,
please? Sure, I'd be glad to. Describe your awareness of our community's changing demographics, the aging of our county, and then tell us how you intend to attract and retain young professionals to Stevens Point.
Growing up in Stevens Point, I've been quite aware of the changes we've gone through. We've always been a very more diverse community than many of the other towns up along the river because of the university. And as we have grown a little bit older, and the greatest generation is now retiring and filling all of our retirement homes and assisted living places, people are stepping up. And Point is a great place, as KB Willett said, a great place to work, live, work, play, and pray. And we've always kept that creed out there in front of everyone, and we've seen it through many awards for Stevens Point being in the top five places to live within Wisconsin and in top 10 in the country. People want to come here. We've got businesses like Skyward, Key Mobility, Berkshire Hathaway, everything that the Knowles have done, everything with the university. People want to come here and work, and we have got such a green community with the Green Circle. They're still coming in, and I believe that's the way we're going to have people come and live in our community.
All right. Thank you. We'll go to District 9 candidates, and we'll start with Mary McComb with that question.
I agree with Tori. To attract and retain young professionals, you need to draw business into the community, and livability, good schools, is what draws businesses in. When I look at young professionals, I see a generation that's much more interested in sustainability than I think previous generations were. And people who are interested in more creative ways of living. I know people are interested in things like co-housing developments or cooperative living, not necessarily just the single family homes. So I'm excited to help with a zoning code that is going to free up neighborhoods to be more neighborhoody. I'd like to see neighborhoods that allow co-housing developments, co-ops, that allow neighborhood businesses again. I have no problem with small manufacturing capabilities in neighborhoods, as long as they don't disturb the neighbors. I would like to see us free up our zoning codes to allow more creative use of our property. I know I helped out a local artist, Stephanie Jones, who was facing some flack because she had artwork in her yard. And our new neighborhood improvement coordinator tells me that he is going to work to help us write codes that allow more creativity for residents.
Okay, thank you. Polly Dalton.
Yeah, I think in talking to residents, I've heard people moving out here, young guys moving out here for manufacturing jobs from Detroit. We're surprised at the housing costs. A retired couple moved here because their son and daughter got a job out here all the way from Vegas. They were surprised at the cost of housing. A family that moved out here from Boston, Massachusetts, had a hard time finding a house that fit their family's needs within their price range. So I think addressing that housing development for young people is one of the sure ways to ensure that they can come here and have a base for themselves as they build whatever life they see for themselves in the future I agree with Marion that that cooperative association housing should be developed within our zoning code by simply if a group of people is interested in organizing as a housekeeping unit, and they can fill out a simple one-page application and live together exempt from occupancy rates. A lot of communities are putting this into play with no problems, and it is helping communities develop. But a lot of economic development is playing this song and dance across all communities. Appleton's trying to attract young people and new businesses. Madison's trying to do it. Milwaukee's trying to do it. And as a young business owner, I moved here to start a business because I saw that it was an affordable place to live and that there were people working on something. So rather than trying to attract new people to come here, I think we also need to focus our economic development on building resources like the 9,000 young people that come here every year for university into staying here.
Thank you. District 3 candidates, and we'll start with Cindy Nabel.
Okay. Hi. This is an interesting one because I think I look back at how old I am now, and when I moved into our house, when we bought our house, I was just only in my 20s. So my husband and I bought our house, and we lived there this whole time. We lived in a diverse neighborhood. We have students living there. I think they keep us young. I think we've helped them. They've helped us. It's a great relationship. It can be a great relationship. But it's one that needs to be looked at, and as we're doing this housing study, we do have to look at different ways that we can have these neighborhoods and we can have different types of lifestyles in there together. I think that everybody can benefit from being close both in the same area. We have a lot of changing demographics, as you're saying, that older people, I've been hearing about people that lived outside in the city, they didn't want to live near everybody, now are getting older, want to move into the city to be able to walk to things and have the walkability. I think you're seeing that more and more with our elderly, and our young are wishing that they had better options to pick for houses, to live in something that's nice and live in a community and be involved and be part of a neighborhood. They're not just students that are out to party. There are a lot of students that really want to have that community relationship and working together with others. So I think it's real important that we look at that, and I think once we do that, we will get those people to stay. They don't want to have to look outward. They'd rather be in town. And I just don't think we have enough options right now. Maybe with our infill, maybe we'll get that. And I hope we do, because it's a great town to live in.
Okay, thank you. And Christopher Villarreal.
Thank you. You realize we have about 9,000 potential young professionals right now with the university? We should be looking at keeping them. They come here for 4 to 5 years, they gain knowledge, they learn the city, and we let them go. We need to bring in industry, not just white collar, but also blue collar industry, so they have jobs when they graduate. If we can keep that knowledge here, we can grow as a community. As far as taking care of the past, I'm not getting any younger either. And we need to start looking at more affordable housing for the ones that are retiring. Better ways to take care of our retirees and the greatest generation. Together with mixing these young professionals or potential young professionals from the university and combining our older professionals, together we can come up with a lot of great ideas to help further our city into making better decisions for both communities and being more diverse. Thank you.
Thank you. We start our next question, we're going to start with our District 9 candidates, and we'll start with Mary McComb. Excuse me. As the city of Stevens Point continues to grow, do you favor expanding outside the city limits or finding ways within the city to accommodate growth?
I'm a proponent of as much infill as possible. Density is what brings in good property tax revenues. If you fill in, say, well, anywhere in the city, you've already got the utilities. You don't have to build new utilities or new roads. You take advantage of what's there. And density creates buzz. I know this is a downtown business owner. I'm always checking out downtowns when I travel. The downtowns that are really doing well, and ours is doing better, they're pretty dense. There's a lot of people there. There's many businesses. There's residences, too. And there's a certain buzz and zest and energy that exists when your city is somewhat dense. I know that we will expand to the east. I really hope we don't expand out to Highway J, which is what is always talked about. That is going to require new sewers, new water, new roads, all that infrastructure for probably large lots, and it's not going to be worth it in terms of property taxes. So I'm definitely a proponent of as much infill as we can do in Stevens Point.
Okay, thank you. And Polly Dalton?
Yeah, it's in the city's best interest to continue to develop within the central area of the community and working out from there and providing with tightening budget limits, providing services that already exist. We can just address them better. We're already serving these areas. Sorry, that's all I have for that one.
Okay, thank you. We'll go to our District 3 candidates, and Christopher Villarreal.
I think we need to look at both, and look at both wisely. Yes, we need to look inside and better ways to grow within the city. But I'm going to use Sun Prairie as an example. I used to live there for many years. I grew up in the Madison area, just south of there, and lived in Sun Prairie when I first moved out of my parents' home. Go to Sun Prairie now.
It's huge.
It is gigantic. And it was forced to not just stay within the city limits. It had to move out. It had to annex. It had to do other things. We at some point are going to have to do that too. We need to be prepared to do that. But at the same time, yes, we need to look at how to improve the inner part of our city, how to build it up, how to make it nicer. But that's also going to attract more people here if they have nice urban neighborhoods that they can move into besides just downtown. We need more apartment spacing downtown. But it would be nice to have suburbs and so forth, just like Sun Prairie is built out in the Windsor area and out towards Token Creek. And that's pretty much where I stand on that.
Okay, thank you. And Cindy Nabel.
Thanks, Chris. Again, I know I'm big on neighborhoods, but that's what I think is our foundation here in Stevens Point. It's one of the things that makes Stevens Point what it is. So I do think that what we've just recently done with expanding in the east area, there were great reasons why that was done, and I think there were some real wins in that one because we weren't having to pay for the infrastructure going out there, but we're still going to have to be able to have our fire and our police department be able to expand that much further out. So it eventually does take a toll. No matter any time that we move further out, it does take a toll. We have areas, and I've had someone ask me, well, where's the infill? Where can we infill? I think there's areas that might have to, like, maybe be looked at and said maybe these need to be restructured. There's areas that are not that beneficial to the city and that could be made into townhouses or things that would be better development. We really need to have a strong town. We need strong neighborhoods. And the neighborhoods that are well-planned and that are well-maintained with balanced housing options will result in raised real estate values. And right now, we don't have that in town. People do outside of town or in Plover. That way, to raise the real estate value is going to raise the value of our existing housing stock. It'll make neighborhoods more attractive and economically diverse body of homeowners that we will all be able to, you know, learn and reap the benefits of. Thank you.
Okay. Tori Jennings.
So the rhetoric that the only place to grow in Stevens Point is east is simply false. Development, as a set of economic principles, development should generate more revenue than it costs. And Mary did a great job of explaining why density brings in good property tax revenue. In other words, density builds wealth because you don't have to build all the services to those sites. that's the good tax base that you want. Residential sprawl, the typical 20th century model of residential sprawl, is not sustainable. It's not a sustainable growth model. It's a failure in terms of planning. And if our city chooses to adopt a planning style or perpetuate a planning style that is a failure, that will be a failure for this city and its economic base. We can do smarter than that. We can be smarter than that. There is lots of infill opportunities, TIF District 5 being a major one. It's a concrete corridor with incredible potential. Lullaby site, areas a little bit to the west of the Lullaby site. We have overly wide roads that have potential for development. So we have lots of opportunity. This doesn't mean that we will never grow east. We will. But we need to prioritize infill and wealth development first.
Okay, thank you. And George Dockstader.
Could you repeat the question again?
Sure. As the city of Stevens Point continues to grow, do you favor expanding outside the city limits or finding ways within the city to accommodate growth?
Well, I think everybody up at the table has hit upon some big ticket issues on that question. It would be great if we could infill. We are trying. Cobblestone Hotels is a great example. We're building. We got rid of that awful mall and moved Midstate up there. So we're growing in the downtown area. We've cleaned up the Lullaby site, and now it's just waiting to have, you know, the right developer to come in, but nobody's bid on it. At the same time, we have to keep expanding. I'd love to see all the infill and see us grow straight up and start putting 5-6-story buildings around, even though we wouldn't be able to see anything and see the river or the parks. So the way the models go, the way the Fox Valley went from Oshkosh to Appleton, that's how cities grow right now, and that's how we grow our tax base. We just keep building a little bit here, a little bit there, and then that pays for itself in the long run. Corey can tell you, you know, it will pay in 10 or 20 years, and then we will start getting some good tax revenues that we can use to start our infill projects. But at the same time, you're going to have all that growth to pay for these streets improvements, and the 160 years that it's going to take the streets department to fix all of the sewer lines, gas lines, and sewer lines. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. We'll move on to our next question, and we'll start with District 3 candidates, and we'll start with Chris Riel, Villarreal. What is the current status of the A Path to Sustainability Stevens Point report from the Eco Municipality Task Force, and what goals would you like to see addressed?
I have to admit, I'm really not up to speed on that, so I'm not going to be able to properly answer that question.
Okay. All right, thank you. Cindy Nabel.
Mm-hmm. I was wondering if I had my notes on it, but it doesn't matter. The Eco Municipality is something that the city has, that the city has a commitment to, and it should. It's got to do with walkability. It's got to do with transportation. It has the revitalization of neighborhoods and the infill. It looks at our groundwater and the importance of that. And there are in the education and also of education in people's, advocacy of people getting involved. We need people to be part of this. It can't be just a couple of people and a board. We need to have our community working together to be sustainable and to be aware and frugal with our resources. We have great natural resources in Stevens Point, and we've been very lucky. Our Parks Department and our city has taken great care of all of those. But groundwater is something that we can run out of. We need to keep it safe, drinking water and our air. Those are all things that are part of the municipal, Eco Municipality, and I'm proud of our city for having that as being our mainstay that we're looking towards for our planning.
Thank you. We'll go to District 1 candidates and start with George Dockstader.
I think we have a pretty thriving eco-municipality. I see what Joel Lemke and the everybody's doing with the water department, water and sewage department, and those guys are pointing us in the right way. They've built a sustainable model down there, which is selling power back to the grid and will be producing fertilizer that we can actually sell within a couple of years. It's just amazing that they can give money back to the city instead of taking it away. And they're working with other businesses like the brewery to keep getting, you know, more product for them, because then they can make more electricity. And so they are almost 100% sustainable over at the water department. The parks department and the bike ped plans are also looking at good eco growth, because they want keep us a green space all the way around the city and have it bikeable in and out with the comprehensive plan with Portage County. Putting in the LED street lights has saved a bunch, and like I said, I want to get City Hall and the police department out of that energy wasting county city building. Thank you.
Thank you. And Tori Jennings.
We are making some progress. At times it feels like a step forward, two steps forward and then a step back. So of course the approval of the TAP grant, and that award is a big deal. So the city will, as long as the council approves it, by 2019 have 13 miles of new bike lanes and share roads in the city. Great point about the water department. We do have a pretty amazing water department in terms of what they're doing and their sustainability efforts. Those are all great things. I think approving the wetland project was a step backwards, and it does give me pause about the commitment the city has to a sustainable future when these kinds of decisions are being made. So I think that's also how things go. There's movement forward, and then there will be some setbacks, and we will work together on that.
Okay. Thank you. Polly Dalton.
Well, the current status of the Eco Municipality Plan is that it exists as a document that testifies to the community that at one time the council cared about moving forward in a sustainable direction. And I think the community is coming up to a number of decisions now where it can really address what was outlined in that document. So I look forward to, as the city thinks about its own facilities and operations, creating a strategic vision for how it can incorporate renewable energy, think about sustainable development within its own operations, and that be that as a testament to the character that is already surrounding this community, whether it be the oldest natural food co-op, one of the oldest natural food co-ops in the country, and a strong base of renewable energy. I think the city can really represent that well and make a statement in some of the investments that it can go. And that's not just the merit of its character alone and what it looks like as a PR stunt, but really as a financial investment for the future. If you're thinking about attracting young people to be here, they see that as a statement, and they say, that's a place where I can be successful long-term because that community cares about its own success in the long-term.
Okay, and thank you. And Mary McComb.
Actually, the Eco Municipality document did take on new life. One of the projects I've been working on in the last couple months was going through the document and talking with various people who were involved in it, either city staff or city volunteers, and get a record of what have we achieved as a city and as a community. And I made a presentation on that at the last council meeting. And I'll just highlight some of the advancements we've made. Writing a new zoning code, and we are currently in the process of a new comprehensive plan, will give us lots of opportunity to put in sustainability principles. In fact, in the comprehensive plan, one of the four guiding principles is sustainability. We've mentioned the water department and the sewage department. We've made good strides in waste collection. We've now got single stream recycling, which is awesome. And then I'm going to call out to Farm Shed. We have made tremendous strides in local food. For the future, I would very much like to see, and the mayor knows this because I've talked with him, at least a sustainability committee on the same model as the bike ped committee, or in the future, I really would like to see a coordinator of sustainability for the city. The eco-municipality framework, not so current anymore. We've been looking into green tier status, and that will continue. As Polly pointed out, sustainability, having a sustainable city, is one of the things that will attract young professionals to Stevens Point.
Thank you. And we are now going to move in to our closing statement time. We are moving closer to our ending point. The closing statement is an opportunity for the candidates to comment on topics not covered in the questions. And again, the order of closing statements will be chosen by random drawing. So our first closing statement will be by Cindy Nabel.
Well, first, I'd just like to make sure that as living in Stevens Point for as long as I have and in my house and being in a campus neighborhood, it has its ups and downs. Every place does. I hear people complain in Plover about their neighbors that are there forever. So I think that we have this interesting, diverse group that we live with that keeps us on our toes, too, as older people in our neighborhood, and also helps us be able to be educators as much as we can for the younger people coming in to first time living off of campus. I think our priorities need our building blocks to strengthen and improve our community. These are the important parts of it. We need to strongly support our police, fire, and ambulance emergency response teams. They're our backbone. They've been there for us. We have to make sure that they have a space that is right for them. Strongly we support that improvements to the infrastructure of our city, ensure our community has clean and healthy drinking water, that wastewater is treated appropriately, which we have a great water department that is doing that. Make sure that we have our inspection department, which is again something that's starting to grow, that to promote safe residences for our children and an eye to toxic environmental concerns and like lead paint and asbestos in some of our older housing stock. Any of these services that we get through the inspection department will help prevent blighted areas from growing more. Be proactive and support growth is what I believe our city needs to be doing, and follow what's worked as we see in other cities, the smart growth. And I strongly support the downtown development and growth along with the residential neighborhoods. I feel it's very important that our neighborhoods, again, they are a big part of our community and they seem to be a lot often last in the line of getting help. And I think if we're going to keep people here, we need to have neighborhoods for them to live in. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next closing statement will be from George Dockstader.
I'd like to thank everybody for coming tonight. This has been quite interesting. The League of Women Voters does a really good job on getting all of our messages out to the citizenry of Stevens Point. 10 years from now, 2027, seems like a long way out, but we all know how fast the months and the years go by now. Our future in 10 years is great. I see growth, I see jobs, I see building our tax base to pay for those road and street improvements. I see tireless promotion by the Stevens Point Convention and Visitors Bureau and Portage County Business Council that are working tirelessly to bring in tourism and new businesses to the Stevens Point and the surrounding area. They're also getting help from Wisconsin Economic Development Corporation, which before I didn't think would do anything, but now I see that it is starting to be a catalyst in bringing business to areas of Stevens Point, like Stevens Point and other cities. One of our big ticket items will be the East Commerce Center. As soon as we can hit the right project there and put in a railway spur, that whole area is going to explode. And the best thing we ever did was start building that grade separation or the Hoover Country Club Drive overpass, because that whole area is, I see it just expanding, and that's where Stevens Point's going to go. At the same time, we got a new, the UWSP Biology Chem building, which is part of infill. That's the biggest thing they've built there since 1974 or 71, and that is also, that's part of the infill, and that will bring in more jobs to our area, and along with Cobblestone and the Parkdale subdivisions and the Whitetail subdivisions that they're going to start building some houses in. We'll have places for these people to move to and have good housing. And thank you to our enthusiastic timers.
Thank you. Our next closing statement, it will be by Polly Dalton.
Our communities are increasingly facing the forces of state and federal pressures with tightening budget, but I think that that's a challenge that this community is interested in stepping up to, because it focuses on increased cooperation amongst residents and businesses that are already existing there, and I think a lot of that character already exists in this community. I think that that development can lead to, with a new neighborhood development coordinator, neighborhood plans, in addition to a comprehensive plans where folks can comment more specifically on the blocks and streets and resources that they see day in and day out, and the swales and potholes that they know are problems, and the playground that has the creaky swing. But I also think, too, that in 10 years we'll see redevelopment of a lot of the smaller scale of a lot of the larger manufacturing and commercial spaces, because the types of businesses that the resources they need to get started are something that are on a smaller scale in order to be initiated and kick off. And I think the city, in addressing its zoning code right now, is poised to be able to leap forward from that.
Thank you. And next will be Mary McComb.
Okay, well, I'm going to tell a little story about Stephanie Pointer, who is a young professional, and she lives in a co-housing unit. Her dad, her old dad, Steve, also lives there in his own facility. And they each wake up one morning, and they don't feel like making their own breakfast, so they make their way over to the co-housing community kitchen and community center, where they dine on local food, local eggs, local raspberries, bread, and who knows, maybe the bread is brought in by drone from Main Grain Bakery. Stephanie is going to work in Wausau today, so she takes the bus downtown to our car sharing service, where she rents a car for a day and drives up to Wausau to do her work. Meanwhile, Steve is an old person, but he's an entrepreneur, and he's started a woodworking business. But because of better zoning, he walks down the street to an old garage that he's repurposed for his woodworking business. They both get home. Stephanie drops off the car, decides to bike home because we've got a great bike sharing service. Time to garden. She goes to the neighborhood tool sharing shed and borrows some tools. She also decides to monitor her water usage with an app, I guess you'd call it, that's being developed now and we should be able to use within a year. Stephanie and her dad decide to go out for a drink. They walk to a local establishment, and it's easy to cross the street because it's only got three lanes. The neighborhood is all buzzing because there's several establishments. They all have outdoor seating, so there is a little bit of a neighborhood buzz. Finally, what do you want after a drink? You want ice cream. So I forgot to mention, they live in District 9, so they've got their choice of Belts or Carl D's. They have their ice cream, they walk home to their co-housing complex, and another wonderful day starts the next morning.
I want to live there.
All right, thank you very much. Our next closing statement will be by Christopher Villarreal.
Thank you. The next 10 years seems like a long ways away, but it wasn't too long ago that I just started being a firefighter. What I see is a downtown that's welcoming to everyone, not just college students, but to adults, and they are adults, to all ages, a place where we can sit and have a beer, a place where everybody can be a part of something where you can feel comfortable just hanging out. I feel the next 10 years, having a stronger job market, having a stronger economy and better wages, students that are graduating and that are confident they can even find a job here in Stevens Point and choose to stay. We can move this city further and further and be more prosperous in the next 10 years by using the knowledge we have and gaining from the knowledge that is coming up in the future. With stronger leadership, we have unlimited potential for the city, and we can do that in the next 10 years. I'd like to say thank you for coming out tonight and allowing me to speak, and I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say. So, thank you.
Thank you. And finally, Tori Jennings.
I believe Stevens Point is a special place with a ton of unrealized potential. And I have such a clear vision of what North Division Street could be with multi-use housing, park space. The potential there is just incredible. And so a lot of that has to do with streets. And the urbanist, Jane Jacobs, talked about our streets are not veins. They're the neurology of a city. And so when I go on and on about streets, as I have, it's because how people move around a city creates a certain kind of environment, and that environment creates a certain kind of community, which brings us back to our streets. So changing, transforming this community is really about looking at these undivided four-lane corridors, doing the 4-to-3 conversions, and then doing the development that comes about as a result of that. That is infill development that builds wealth, that increased tax base gets plowed back into services that serve all residents. And that's what I'm really interested in, making this a great place to live for everybody that lives here.
Thank you. Thank you to all the candidates for the time and energy they have invested in running for their district positions on the City Council and for participating in this forum. Feel free to stay to talk with the constituents afterwards, and be sure to stop by the candidates' table if you're interested in their literature. On April 4th, voters will also be voting for several other offices, including State Superintendent of Public Instruction, a Wisconsin Supreme Court Justice, and a Court of Appeals Judge, District 4, which includes Portage County. A candidate guide with questions answered by these candidates is available on the State League website. League contact information, including our website, email, and mailing address, is available at the League table in the back. There are several other local elections as well, including board members for the Stevens Point Area Public School District, city clerk, city comptroller treasurer, and city attorney, so it will be a full ballot. This concludes the forum for the Stevens Point Common Council Alderpersons. Thank you, candidates and audience, for your participation and attention. And again, we also wish to thank John Quirk, who has taped and will replay the forums on Community TV Channel 984, and those times are in the back as well. These broadcasts are an appreciated service to the Portage County area citizens. Thank you to the League members who volunteered in various roles this evening that made the forum possible. We couldn't do it without all of them. And thank you to Portage County for allowing the use of this facility. The League believes that when you vote, you are participating in one of the most basic and important responsibilities you have as a citizen. When you vote, you are empowering your political voice. Please remember to vote on April 4th. And now let us show our appreciation to all the candidates, and have a good evening.